Hi, welcome. So in this video, we will be talking about ICU essentials. Okay, that essential element of ICU running, very important, because in earlier videos, we have learned about ICUs, the infrastructure design, planning. But when it comes to running, there are few elements which without which you cannot like work or run an ICU effectively, especially about the fire, water, then you have infection control, and all this thing combined together, it's very essential in effective running of ICU.
ICU outcome is directly proportional to the way it is planned and the way it is managed. Basically, don't have to have a good infrastructure. You also have to have good expertise in managing the ICU. Because it is a big hassle, but once done well, it serves you in life. Right. So basically, you should emphasize, we are emphasizing on these points because each of them is very important for the day-to-day running of ICU.
Yes. Okay. So in this video, we were going to learn these essential elements. Okay.
What are the ICU essentials?
Yes.
Important go into stuff. This. Basically, first thing is the checklist. So we are giving this checklist for whatever things we should not miss any of them. Fire, how to manage the fire, if at all, or how to prevent it. Human resources, very important for the ICU. Then provision of alternate supply of oxygen lines. Infection prevention, this affects the ICU outcome. Meeting the needs of the relatives, because they are under stress all the time. And then water, which is uninterrupted, clean and RO. Basically, these 7 points are very critical in day-to-day running of ICU.
Absolutely. See, if you go and see that this important checklist, the checklist of ICU planning, the fire, human resource, these are the things which will run your ICU. And if fire, if you're not taken care, most of the fire, as per data, most of the fire starts from ICU, because there is a mesh of oxygen supply pipelines, gas pipelines, and then there are electricity wires, water, RO waters, and all those things are so much complicated. If it is not planned properly and executed properly, then it leads to fire. So that is very important, how to deal with fire. Then human resource, again, it's very operation intensive thing. So human resource needs to be properly planned, and all of the things like meeting the needs of relative. Now this is also should be taken care, because we do not take care about this aspect, but this is the important element. Otherwise, there will be rush. There will be like people will be going into the ICU, which is actually not allowed. Then it will be difficult for people, for the people who are managing the HR people to manage the patient or their relatives. So yeah. If you give a proper space for the people to stay back and sit, then it is much more manageable.
Even they need to be counseled from time to time, because they're in the high stress and patient is really unstable. So you should keep updating them about that situation, so that they are also having clarity about how the patient is behaving. And yeah, it's very critical for the medical legal purpose also.
Correct.
Otherwise,
correct.
If they are not satisfied by the explanation, they usually sue you. And yes, if you are explaining them well, even if the outcome is not favorable, then they will still trust the doctor that correct. He did his best.
Yes, yes. And that is why the human interaction here, human resource with the relatives, and these are very, very critical element, yeah, apart from all the technical stuff. Okay. So let's go deep one by one in this document, in this topic, especially the fire and the oxygen supply, the space and infection control. These needs to be done in deep. So let's go into the mind map and understand all this stuff. Yeah, so from planning point of view, we should be having a checklist. Otherwise, we might miss one or two points.
First thing is to find out your aim and objective. So what are you going to target? Are you only a critical care unit, or you are going to supply some supportive help to the critical unit?
Mm-hmm.
Like there can be a ICU which is itself ICU plus medicine unit backup.
Okay.
But there can be an ICU which is going to serve to the neurology or cardiology or
okay,
some special setup.
Yeah.
So to plan it according to that.
Okay.
Then you should see where it is located, what space, facility.
Yeah.
We already discussed which is top floor.
Yeah.
Minus one floor or first floor if
there is. And no different kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Then you should know about the budget also, that how much you're going to invest.
Very
then
important.
The resource allocation should be according to that.
Yes, obviously.
You cannot make 50 beds and then 25 beds are also not workable for ICU.
Yeah.
Then coming on to the levels of ICU, like first level is the basic, the ward, second is HDU, third is the tertiary care unit.
Mm.
Then upon the number of beds, because if you make more than 12 beds in one ICU, difficult to manage.
Yeah.
And if you require multiple units, then 12 beds, you get up for 5 units.
Yeah.
As per the institutional requirement.
Yeah.
Then coming on to the every bed designing.
Yeah.
Whether you're giving adequate space to the beds, because very, very crampy ICU will be more prone to infections, and there will be a lot of cross infections if you don't give adequate space. Modulation according to the various type of speciality, space availability. And we have discussed that pendant versus head end, what is the advantage, disadvantage. Then central nursing station designing.
Again,
team formation should be very, very important part, because close coordination between these units are very important, because they learn from each mistakes that they're doing. So there should be ICU repeated, there should be upgradation of knowledge and discussion in between ICU nurses and the doctor. And data collection analysis, because you learn from your own data and you improve upon that. If you don't have data collection, you'll not realize that last year what did you do and how much you have grown in the year.
So these are the complete comprehensive checklist when you are planning for ICU. And if you follow like step by step this thing, I don't think you need anyone's help or any hospital architect for that. You can do, but if you are having very sophisticated designing in your mind, then you can always and should be actually consult a hospital architect. Okay.
They will not give the actual idea, because you are the best person to decide what you want to make.
That's what.
He will actually put the things in place. You should give the, whatever the menu you should give. And he will place the menu in the plate for according to his...
But for menu, these videos are very, very necessary. So you should understand all these things, because hum log ne dekha apne client ko ki they actually leave everything to the hospital architect or architect, and then they decide.
And then he doesn't know, because he cannot say no to you. And he doesn't know. And at the same time, he doesn't have all the information. So he creates something, and then you have to recreate it.
So it is very important. You should take the
proper interest.
You should take the proper interest in this designing as well as the planning time, because otherwise everything will be in the hands of someone else who doesn't have your vision or your way of thinking, and then things will not be as good as you wanted. Okay, so let's talk about the another feature, which is about the fire, and very, very important feature. In this module we will talk a detail about firing.
See, fire in the ICU is like a disaster. So you have to see, it should not be happening, it should be prevented, and it should be at all costs should be localized, because it is not always that possible to evacuate all the sick patients.
Because most of the ICU,
there is a lot of suffocation, and not only the burns, but the suffocation kills the
suffocation
patient.
And those patients who are in ICU will not be able to evacuate themselves. They will not be able to run or walk.
So even they are, if they are evacuated, they might not survive. Because of the smoke and because of the oxygen requirement and all those things, the fire spreads like anything. So it usually goes through the duct. So as a rule, the ducting should not be connected to any other facility at all. And then you should have hammers for breaking the ICU glass if you are having big window panels.
And I think at the planning stage, you should be like focusing on two things. Like, one is your complete prevention of the fire. Complete prevention. And if something happens, how I can localize those
The fire gates should be placed in such a way that...
So while designing, when you're talking to your hospital architect or any general architect, you should be actually focusing on like, if something happens, how I can isolate this part of the building from other part, right?
See, fire... If you have not taken adequate precautions, if you think that fire will happen everywhere but not in my hospital, it is not there.
It's like kind of any accident, like in you're on a road, so it can happen.
And it does not tell before that I'll happen today. So you should always take precautions. Then there should be exit and escape route should be very, very well. Signage should be given in local languages, and even in the night they should be visible, because the light usually goes away. So they should be radium plated or visible in the night also, when there is no light. Then you should have an emergency exit and staircase for the people to get evacuated and internal disaster which happens. In the ICU, you should be have a very, very important point is that in the ICU, either the hand dryer should be away from the wall of the taps, or it should be prevented altogether. It should not be there.
I think it should. It is better to avoid the electrical hand dryer, because there is a possibility of spark in this in dryer. So it is so. If it is possible, please avoid it. And in place of hand dryer, you should have
disposable towels.
Disposable towels. And
all the area should be under automatic sprinkler system. And even nowadays, the mist system is also very well taken. And because it requires less water, less space you have to allocate for the fire tank. And smoke detector should be deployed at wherever it is required.
And most of these will be are necessary when you are going for NABH, right? And you might be going for NABH accreditation. So these will be covered. So it is better you should, in the planning stage, you should have all these things. And it is better for your hospital owner. Like if there is a cost associated, please bear that cost, because this will save you like lot of other costs. So let's talk about the human resource.
Human resources ICU is very important factor, because they are the people who are going to save the patients for you. Very important is to have a very good intensivist if you get a critical care specialist, who is the captain of the ship.
Yeah,
he is going to drive the outcomes for your ICU. Resident doctors are like a backbone. They are there in the round the clock duties, and they are in the main player for you. Nursing officers and managers, 1:1 for ventilator, 1:2 or 1:3 for less sick patients. Then respiratory therapist or a good physiotherapist is very important. They will do the respiratory job for you. Nutritionist for maintaining the patient's nutrition day to day. Clinical pharmacist, technicians, computer programmer, because we have now all the HIMS system and all the setup. So that is very important. So that will save the time of sisters, and they can work more focus on the patient management. Biomedical engineer should be always available
for devices
around the clock 24/7. Because for all the kind of ventilators and monitors, at least adequate number of biomedical engineers should be there. Social worker who will guide with the patient, and counselor who will tell about the patient counseling, and very important is to talk to the patient's relatives.
Okay.
So that is required. So basically these all are required, and according to the size of the ICU, this can be decided how many
is required. Okay, cool.
Then coming on to the alternate supply of oxygen, it is absolute a must to have a separate supply line in the form of cylinders, because we cannot believe or we cannot trust on one source. Okay,
this is like having a
backup plan,
because you can't play with the life of a patient.
Then very important is infection prevention. So all the beds should have a sanitizer, and every fifth bed you should have a wash basin.
Okay.
And not only a wash basin, you should ask the sisters and nurses, sisters and doctors, to do the hand washing. So an interesting thing which we did in our hospital was, every hour there used to be an announcement in the ICU.
Okay.
That it is the hand washing time, let's wash the hands.
Let's wash the hands.
So it is kind of a routine that every 1 hour everybody will wash the hands.
So it is an alarm clock for everybody, so that they remember and they don't forget.
Just like a dong ding dong bell, there will be a washing time.
Washing
for
2 minutes. It important, because many people, because of the hectic work schedule, they don't care about it, or they forget these things. So it is the management whose responsibility is to get this thing done.
In fact, the most important notion in most of the doctors is that we are ultra clean, because
we are doctors,
so we are clean. It is not like that. The most dirty hands are found in doctors only. The most less compliant are the doctors. So we should understand the importance of hand washing, and then patient how much what should be the ideal place should be allocated for the patient relatives to sit. So it should be 2 seats per patient bed. And then RO water is required for the dialysis. So uninterrupted, clean and sterile RO water should be available.
So you should be take that into account while planning your drainage and all those things.
Yeah,
right?
Drainage and housekeeping should be given adequate space.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they will give all the jhadu and everything in the ICU.
I hope you have learned a lot about ICU. Now you are able to understand how it is running is so much critical and so much tedious than actually making it much more easier. So if you have any other questions apart from what might have missed something, so you can ask below this video and we will try to answer them. And
Please like, share
and press the bell icon, because if this kind of video, informative video, whenever there is launch, you will get the notification. So please press it, and please share with your friends and relatives and anywhere your colleagues who is in need of ICU infrastructure, and they are already have the ICU but they are not running it properly. They can get a few insights from it. Okay.
And if you want to learn more about it, then we have a free webinar in the times to come.
Yeah,
you can click the links below and join the webinar. We will understand a lot of more things other than the ICU management, also for the medical entrepreneurship and the healthcare. And we'd like to see you there.
Yeah, please do that. There is a link below this video of the next masterclass of the workshop we are conducting about the healthcare entrepreneurship, and where we will tell you about much more deeper level how healthcare is evolving and how you can make career and how you can run your business and how you can do service to the society. Everything is covered in well-defined manner. So please register. We will see you in the workshop. And I hope you like this video and this series, especially by ICU series, a lot. Okay. So check out more videos in the channel, and please give your feedback. Bye-bye. Take care. God bless.